Good morning, everyone. Hey, welcome to Church at the MHC. So glad you guys are tuning in with us today. Hey, get your prayer requests in. We want to pray for you. We want to love on you. We want to stand with you. So get those in this morning. It's going to be a great day. It's Palm Sunday. We're gearing into the Easter holiday. It reminds us of what the Lord has done, that the resurrection and the crucifixion through that, what Jesus did for us, the Father did through giving his only son for us. So it's a great day to be reminded of that, to know that our sins are paid for, as well as, you know, Jesus paid the price for every sin, sickness, and disease. And so it's a great time to be remembering that. And I just look forward to what God's doing now and Easter and through this season. We should remember it all the time, but now is a great time to really bring that to our memory and really remember that. Hey, so today is Sunday. We will have Tuesday night healing school. That will be online only from here on out until we find somewhere. We are believing that is going to be moved into a different location very, very soon. I believe it will. So that will be online only, as well as we will have Wednesday night church service at 7 p.m. next Wednesday. So join us for that as Pastor Don is going into a series, getting us ready for this summer and what God's doing this summer and what we need to know. We need to know who we are, so we know what we possess, so we can go out and reach these people. Also, Friday night prayer was supposed to be at the Luby Stage Friday, but the wind came in, it got cold, it got a little misty out, so we did it inside, but we'll be watching the weather. Hopefully we can get back to the Luby Stage this Friday to pray and to reach. You know, someone was saying, oh, we need to be handing out flyers for the summer, so you know, that's part of it. We're going to do that, so I invite you to join us for that. And then, of course, you know, we're always here Sunday morning 10 a.m. for church at the MHC, so I encourage you to be a part of that, to come and be expecting for that as well. But anyways, get your prayer request in. We love you guys. So glad you're tuning in for us. Thank you for making MHC your church home. If you decide that maybe that you don't want to put your prayer request in the comment section, you can give us a call at 573-216-1871, and you can give us a call. One of our prayer team members will pray for you. They would love to do that for you. So that's another option. I usually push the email, but I just found out that the email, we're still working on getting that going. And then also, if you feel led to give into these summer bands or summer concerts or church being moved down to the stage, you can text to give at 888-546-7317, text give and the amount to, or of course, you know, you can always mail a check, as well as doing like that, 728 North Main Street, Lori, Missouri. But wherever you feel led, you know, Pastor Nathan said, you know, last week, maybe it was him, I don't remember, somebody said, you know, there's something that you can be praying about giving. You know, we're believing for the back lot. We're believing for finances for these bands. We're believing for other things. And so there, you know, be praying. What does the Lord want you to sow into? Maybe it's one of those things. Maybe it's just the church in general. Whatever it is, the Lord will show you where to put it and where it's supposed to be earmarked for. So I encourage you guys to do that if that's something you feel led to do. We just got a few minutes here, and I don't see a lot of prayer requests yet, but stay tuned, and we will pray for you after service. So if one comes up or you are just hopping on, you can definitely still comment that, and then we will pray for you after service. But I want to get us into service with a prayer. So Father God, I just lift up everyone watching today. Father, I thank you for what you're doing in their lives. I thank you for what you're doing in their lives, in their bodies today, Father. Father, I thank you that today's word that's coming forth will not just become head knowledge, but revelation knowledge, revelation power, Father. And Father, I think that preaching is not with enticing words, but with power and demonstration of your power, Father. And I just thank you for, I thank you for what you're doing in these people's lives. I thank you for the people that you have brought into this church, into this place, this family. And Father, so I just thank you that you are, that they are blessed, that they are prosperous, that they are healed, and that they are whole. And I just thank you for it. I thank you for what you're doing in their lives. And I thank you that they will receive everything that you want them to receive out of today's service. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we love you guys. Hey, we're going to go out to worship. And I will see you on right after church to pray for you. So get those prayer requests in. We love you guys. And we're going to go out to George.
Good morning, MHC. Oh, that was weak. Golly, come on now, wake up. Good morning, MHC.
Good morning.
Come on, hallelujah. Come on, let's stand. Let's get into worship this morning. Hallelujah. Woo. Come on, get off your feet this morning. Hallelujah. Woo. We're excited to be in the house of the Lord. Amen.
Yes.
It's exciting to be here.
Yes,
hallelujah. Hug somebody's neck this morning. Tell them you're glad to see them. Hallelujah. Whoever it is, doesn't matter who it is. Could be the person next to you, could be the person that you don't know. You never know. We're all family here. Hallelujah. Come on, let's stretch our hands to heaven this morning. Come on, it's good to praise in the house of God. Amen. Oh, come on. I said it's good to praise God. Come on. Come on. He's done too much for you not to praise him. Amen.
That's right.
Come on, hallelujah. Come on, let's get into the atmosphere this morning. Oh, come on, praise him with everything you got. Come on. Father, we praise your name. We praise your name, Jesus. Come on, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, shout Jesus this morning. Shout Jesus. Hallelujah. Hey, come on. One, two, three. Ha. Come on, clap. Come on. Let everything.
Let everything.
That has breath.
That has breath.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Let
everything
that has breath.
That has breath.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Come on.
Praise the Lord.
I praise in the valley. Praise on the mountain. Hey. I praise when I'm sure. Praise when I'm doubting. Woo. I praise when outnumbered. Praise when surrounded. Cause praise is the water my enemies drown in. Come on, shout! Woo! As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. I praise when I feel it. Praise when I don't. I praise cause I know you're still in control. Come on, do you believe that? Our praise is a weapon. It's more than a sound. Hey, my praise is the shout that brings Jericho down. Oh, as long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord. Oh, my soul. Come on, you say. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Come on, clap, come on. Come on, I think we need to do the verses again. Oh, come on. Verse one. I praise in the valley. Come on. I praise in the valley. Praise on the mountain. Come on, you sing. I praise when I'm sure. Praise when I'm doubting. Come on. I praise when I'm numbered. Praise when surrounded. Hey, hey. 'Cause praise is the water my enemies drown in. Oh, come on. As long as I'm breathing, I got a reason to praise. Oh, my soul, praise the Lord, oh, my soul. Come on. I praise when I feel it, praise when I don't. I praise because I know, come on. I praise because I know you're still in control. My praise is a weapon. Hey, it's more than a sound. Come on, my praise is the shout. My praise is the shout that brings Jericho down. Come on. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord for my soul. Come on, this next part says, I praise because you're sovereign, praise because you reign, praise because you rose and defeated the grave. Come on. Come on, you better shout this morning. Come on. Woo-hoo! I praise because you're sovereign, praise because you reign, praise because you rose and defeated the grave. Praise because you're faithful, praise because you're true. Praise cause there's nobody greater than you. I pray. Praise cause you're faithful. Praise cause you reign. Praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I praise cause you're faithful. Praise cause you're true. Praise cause there's nobody greater than you. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Come on. Be quiet, I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How can I keep it inside? Praise the Lord. Oh my, come on, let's worship, do it. Come on. Praise Put your hands together. Woo! Come on, I need to hear you loud and proud this morning. Come on. Whoa. Let everything
that has breath
praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Let everything.
That has breath.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Come on, do it again.
Praise the Lord.
Let everything.
Let everything.
That has breath.
That has breath.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Woo! Woohoo! Hallelujah.
Yes.
Come on. Woo! Come on, lift up a shout of praise in the house this morning. Come on. Come on, he's worthy of it. Come on, don't be shy. Hallelujah. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, just lift your hands. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Come on, right now we cast out the darkness. Come on, right now we cleanse the heart, right now. Hallelujah. Come on, we stir up something inside of us this morning. Hallelujah. Come on, do you feel him this morning? Do you feel his presence this morning? Do you feel that stirring? Hallelujah. Come on, revival's already broke out in Missouri. In case you didn't know, about 4.5 hours away from here, hallelujah, they've had service every single night and had 500 or 600 people show up to a town of 700. Come on, you think, why? How does that work? God. That's how that works. Now, I'm going to ask you, why not here? Come on, this is a town of 900, is it not? Come on. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for sweeping revival over this region. Over this state, God. Come on, let it revive our hearts, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, it's time for the dead man's team.
It's
time for the dead man to rise. Time for the great light to shine. I hear the Spirit say, it's time. Let the King of glory come riding on your people's praise. Let the King of glory in. Let the King of glory in. Fling wide you heavenly gates. Let the King of glory in. Let the King of glory in. Come riding on your people's praise.
Let the King of glory in.
Let the King of glory in. Oh, come on, put your hands together this morning. Come on.
Open up the windows, let the light in. Open up the windows, let the light in. Let the light in, let the light in. Open up the windows, let the light in. Open up the windows, let the light in. Open up the windows, let the light in. Let the light in.
Come on,
let the light in.
Open up the windows, let the light in. Open up the windows, let the light in. Open up the windows. Let the light, let the light, sing it again. Open up the windows, let the light, open up the windows. Let the light, open up the windows. Let the light, let the light, come on. Open up the windows, let the light, open up the windows. Let the light, open up the windows. Let the light, let the light, let the light, open up the windows. Let the light in, open up the windows. Let the light in, open up the windows. Let the light in, let the light in, let the light in. Bring wide you heavenly gates. Let the King of glory in. Let the King of glory in. Come riding on your people's praise. Let the King of glory in. Let the King of glory in. Fling wide you heavenly gates. Let the King of glory in. Let the King of glory in. Come riding on your people's praise. Let the King of glory in. Drums and voices.
Let the King of glory in.
Heavenly gates. Let the King of glory in. Let the King of glory in. Come riding on your people's praise. Come on.
Let the King of glory in.
Let the King of glory in. Oh, come on, lift him up this morning. Come on, give him a little time right now. Come on, give him a little glory right now. Give him a little praise right now. Come on, is he worthy? Is he worthy? Hallelujah.
Josh had some blood work done, and it showed that his liver, the alkaline phosphate and the ISO enzymes, was really high. So they did another test and broke it down and said it was 60% liver, 40% bone. Next step is the MRI. I'm thankful for doctors and what they catch, but I know what his almighty doctor is.
That's right.
So I just wondered if we could pray over his liver and his bones, from what they say.
Yep.
I know when they do the MRI, they won't see anything.
That's right. So.
Absolutely.
Amen.
So church, it's time to be the church. So we're going to come up here and we're going to lay hands on him. We're going to transmit something much greater than what the doctor said. During that, I was reminded of, well, the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and if they committed any sins, they shall be forgiven. But did you catch it, though? Was that not the prayer of faith? How did you guys know to come down and lay hands up on him? How did you know that? It's the prayer of faith. Your faith is activated, and when you knew there was a need, you didn't stay comfortable. You got out and you put your hands, you put something tangible upon him, which transmitted something. And isn't it funny that you even put the name of Jesus in your mouth and on your lips? Because it says the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. So whatever they called that, whatever names that they gave to it, it had to bow its knee to a name that was greater. Amen. So what do we expect? Exactly what we said. Resurrection life. Amen. So God put that liver in there. He did put that liver in there in the beginning, and it was failing or problems wrong, and he looked at it and said, and it's good. So we just bring it back to the original genesis of the whole thing. The pattern of what? Perfection in his body. So that's what we're standing on. Thank God for a church like this. Don't preach. All right, I hear it. I heard it, and I got to obey it. I get it. Well, you haven't heard nothing yet, because now we're talking about Tuesday Night Healing School. Okay. So, hey, guys, if you guys have never been or heard of Tuesday Night Healing School, I know that we have some new people in the house, but it's an opportunity to hear God's word, that it's always his will and his word to heal, no matter what. Well, what if I was the cause of it? Absolutely. Yeah, God still heals no matter what. He created that body and he knows how to take care of it. Amen? So we learn that on Tuesdays. We learn that it's always God's will to heal, but we also learn how to do what we just did. Why did you guys come up and lay hands on him? Because you believed that, well, somebody lives in you and that somebody wants him healed and he's going to use you to do it. So we learn that, so wherever we go in life, the gas station, the grocery store, no matter where it is, we're always aware that we can transmit something greater into them. We learn that at Tuesday Night Healing School. We're not meeting in person for right now. We're meeting online only. So on Tuesdays, 6:30 p.m., go to Two Guys in the Bible Facebook page, and we'll be able to be live on there to where we do a teaching and a ministry on healing school. Another thing that we are doing right now, Wednesday night church service. Some of you guys have been to our Wednesday night church services. How many of you guys are going to start coming? Raise your hands. No, Pastor Don, through the leading of Holy Spirit, told him to stop his series on Not Guilty. Now, I don't know about you, but that's one of my favorite series. So for him to stop the truth of that to get a different truth to us, which is, who in the world are you? How many of you guys plan on going out on the Luby stage, the strip, this summer and kicking some demon tail? I'm proud of myself. I corrected on what I said on that. She's like, please don't say that. We have to learn the truth of who in the world are we, because sickness is going to ask you, who are you? Your checkbook is going to say, well, who are you? We have to answer back according to how God sees us, not how the enemy is telling us what we are in that moment that we mess up or whatever it is in life. It's like Pastor Don says, you'll hold up that Bible and he'll say, hey, here's the mirror. Find yourself in here. Here's the mirror. Guys, when it says, who in the world are you? We're going to be able to answer back, sons and daughters. Be here Wednesdays, every Wednesday, online and in person. Be here Wednesday, 7 o'clock p.m. for that series. Another thing is Friday night hour of power prayer. It is every Friday, 6:30 to 7:30. We were going to meet at the Strip, down on the Luby stage this last Friday, but the weather came in. It dropped quickly. Moisture was in the air. We want you guys to not freeze to death while you're out there, but we want you to feel comfortable when you come, because what we're doing is we're getting our feet on the ground and we're getting comfortable with our surroundings, but they're being comfortable somewhat seeing us there. Because here's the thing, we're not backing off. So whether they like it or not, we're going to be there. So we're going to look into this Friday for the weather. We want you guys to be there, 6:30 to 7:30. We're just going to go and we're going to pray over that area and we're going to release what God wants to do. We're not twisting God's arm in this. We're just coming into agreement that he wants people saved, and we're going to be the ones with the gospel on our lips telling them about the goodness of God. So this Friday, 6:30 to 7:30, down at the Strip on the Luby stage. If for some reason weather comes in again, we'll let you guys know, but we will not cancel. We will meet here and we will still pray. How many of you guys love church at the MHC on Sunday mornings? I was going to say, you're here, so either you got drug here or something. But, you know, I met some new people this morning. It was neat because she just said, I felt the presence of the Holy Spirit. Man, we haven't even started worship yet. That's kind of awesome, guys. That there's so much of an atmosphere that when you even get out of your car, before you even get into the building, there's just a knowing of like, okay. Yeah, I'm in the presence of God. Guys, this is awesome. This is what we do. But did you know something even more important? It's just not meant to stay here upon this stage and in this room. We are the carriers of his glory. So no matter where you go, you're a releaser of that. Amen? So every Sunday, 10 a.m., online and in person, we want you guys here. We're going places. Another thing I want you to be a part of is the Passover Seder meal. How many of you guys went to that last year? It was amazing, guys. It was very intimate. It was like you were there. It was very special. Well, guys, we're doing it again this year. It's going to be April 17th, which is a Wednesday, 6:30 p.m. It is a $5 offering that we ask you to at least put in just to help cover some things, because there's going to be different meats, different things that they ate during that time. But we ask you, if you're coming, if you will look it up online, a side dish that is appropriate for Passover. There is a sign-up sheet out in the lobby that you can sign up for to bring that side dish. But we want you to be a part of that. Again, it will be April 17th, which is a Wednesday, 6:30 p.m., and there is a sign-up sheet out there. Let me get through a lot of this. Another thing that we have, guys, we're asking you, if God puts this upon your heart, we are looking for finances, for some seed to be sown. You see this awesome drum set that we have over here behind all that, and he does a good job playing it. He is anointed and gifted to play that right there. That's worship to him. But guys, we don't want to have to tear that down, set it up every week. We want a drum set that we can get with the proper mics that will go just set up for that stage. Because he has electric at home, but it doesn't sound the same out there. We're looking for every instrument to echo and to go as far as we can see. Even people that are out there on that water. What is that noise? Well, they're being tuned in to just something other than noise. They're being tuned in and they're hearing the anointing. It's pulling them in. Is that possible? Well, absolutely. Absolutely it is. So with that being said, we're looking for finances for a new drum set and mics. That's probably going to be around $2,000. So if that's upon your heart, guys, if you do make a checkout, whatever it is, please mark on that envelope or in that memo area of that check what that's for, so we have it specifically donated just for that right there. We're also looking for finances. We're looking to get billboards out there, radio, TV, whatever we can do to get the news out there. This is where we're going to be. Because, guys, this is it. You know, I remember Pastor Don saying this many a times, and it always got my attention. He said, this is not a dress. He said, this isn't a dress rehearsal. And when I hear that, it makes you take a step back and really look at your life. What am I doing to make an impact for the kingdom? Because when it's all said and done, when you strip everything away and all the people that praised you and all the people that celebrated you and all the people that wanted to see you fail, at the end of it, it doesn't matter. You're going to stand before one person, the person that we're worshiping today, and you're going to hear, well done. How many guys want to hear that? I want to hear well done. From the littlest things to the big things. But I look at what we're doing this summer as normal Christianity, but I look at it as big because there's millions of people that come in. Now you think of millions of people that are coming in. Can this group right here make an impact and reach all them? As loud as you can. Say, absolutely. Absolutely. And say, I will. Get out of my comfort zone. And I will partake on bringing the gospel to a lost and a dying world. Now I'm going to hold you accountable for that because I know where you live. So, yeah. With that being said, there's connect cards in the back. We need you to go ahead. And but with that being said, truth, we will not stalk you, I promise. But we do want to be able to celebrate birthdays. Things happen so quickly around here. When Holy Spirit says to do something, we don't go into prayer about it. We go into action, which means, hey, today's Sunday. We could be doing something tomorrow. I don't know. But we want you to participate in that. So if you are new, there are connect cards on that back table. We want you to put the information on there so we can get a hold of you to let you know, hey, we're doing this. We would love to have you present there. We want your supply of faith. That allows us to be able to partake in that with you and you with us. Amen. So with the finances that I believe that are going to come in today for this, did you know that we said that on one time? And did you know within one moment, the children's room, the finances for that came in? You think God cares about our children being ministered to? Absolutely. With that being said, I need you after church to go down that stairway right there, and you're gonna be able to see all the drywalls put up. And you're going to be able to see it more clearly, the vision that we have, that guess what? You hooked up with us on that because you sowed seed into that. You know, and seed is more than just finances. It's your prayer. It's you being willing to pour into those kiddos. Maybe you're not working downstairs, but you see those kiddos come into church. Go release what God's telling you over those children. Man, you're a champion. You're loved. Those children absorb that. Do you know that? You're putting seed into your life, into their life. So with that being said, we want you to go downstairs after church. We want you to see there is more work to be done, but it's getting done very quickly, and those children will have their own area. Because isn't it neat? They're going to be able to look and pick what they want as a design for that room. Why? Because it's their room. Kind of important, isn't it? That's awesome. I love it, guys. Hey, guys, we got some birthdays, and we're going to sing it different today than country.
Right, okay. Sure.
Maybe some Guns N' Roses style Motley Crue. I don't know. I don't know. So, guys, these are the birthdays that we're going to celebrate. Baby Josie, whoops, my bad. Baby Josie's first birthday party celebration is today, following church. Her birthday is March 28th, this Thursday. We also have Miss Hancock, Sarah's birthday. We have it March 23rd. That was yesterday. Man,
yep.
I need to get caught up on my time. Dave Lucas, he is not here today. Hopefully they're watching online. I know he said they had to go into some different states and do some work. His was March 17th, but we didn't get to sing happy birthday to him. Ray's birthday, Mr. Henry here, March 22nd. He's like rubbing his face. Oh, my. You are loved, my man. I could have. You're right. But sometimes prophetic just flows, so. No. Hey, Ray's birthday was the 22nd. And we also have George and Sarah's anniversary the same day as Josie's birthday on March 28th.
We didn't plan that, by the way, so you know.
So however you're going to sing those,
okay.
Let her fly. Other than that, guys, when we're done, we're going to get into offering.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Indira. Happy birthday to you. One more time. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. There, I didn't do country. You happy? Golly. Jeez. They've been on me for months. Change the birthday song.
Okay, fine.
All right. Before I go into offering, I just wanted to touch base about Passover a little bit. I wanted to explain that in case some of you hadn't done Passover before. But it's really just a holy dress rehearsal is what it's called in Hebrew. It's just practicing for when Christ came and did a supper with us and then practicing again because we believe this will be the marriage supper that we celebrate with him in the end. But just really getting to see Christ in the Passover. But I wanted to, I found this funny little video I wanted to share with you before I did offering. So enjoy. Like Jesus coming, you don't know when the tape's coming, but it's coming. It's coming, I promise. Okay, you can cut it. Okay, so that's a little bit of Passover. So we're supposed to see ourselves as Israelites, because what the Bible tells us is that testimony is our testimony. We share in it. We were once slaves, now we're free. So we do that meal. It was commanded, as often as you do this. And a lot of times we take the drink and the bread as a church service and we remember that. But he told us to do this every year, to remember him as Christ the Passover. So I just want you to know how important it is and how much you'll see Christ in this. Thank you, Dylan. All right, so for offering this morning, I want to read Matthew 6:7. It says, "When you pray, there is no need to repeat empty phrases, praying like the Gentiles do, for they expect God to hear them because of their many words. There is no need to imitate them, since your Father already knows what you need before you ask him." So he says, pray like this: "Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread." I stop there to remind you that your Father is a good Father, and he says to us, "My child, come before me and ask, for I know what you need before you even ask. See me as your Father." You need to position yourself in such a way that you know you don't have to persuade me with many words. I know your daily need, and I will take care of you daily. It reminds me of Exodus 17, where the Israelites were told to go and gather their manna, and some gathered a lot, and some gathered a little, but when they came back to their tent, they all had the exact amount God wanted for them. So we rest in his goodness that God provides for us. But I want to also read Matthew 7:8. It says, "For everyone who keeps on asking receives, and he who keeps on seeking finds, and to him who keeps on knocking, the door will be opened." In here, Jesus instructs us to keep on asking. And oh, how this had confused me for many years. You just said in the previous chapter, we don't need to use many words. Just ask, and you know our needs, and you'll provide them. But when I read that, it says, I realized that this verse is about gifts, not our daily needs. So I realized that God is inviting us to communicate often about our dreams, our wishes, and our desires. What are you dreaming with God for? He's not only a God of daily provision, he's a God who gives good gifts. Today, I want you to start dreaming with God. What is in your hearts that you could not accomplish on your own, but is a dream, a gift, a desire? Now we'll look at verse 12. It says, "So then, whatever you desire that others would do to you and for you, even so, do also to and for them. For this sums up the law of the prophets." Did you catch that? As you do for others, God will do for you. Isn't that a beautiful picture? As we co-labor with heaven, we also co-labor with each other. You co-labor with the vision of MHC. This house has dreams and visions, and when you provide for us, he provides for you as well. Kingdom is partnership. God spoke with me one day as I was telling him, well, whining, but I was telling him, "God, why do you seem to take so long sometimes to answer when we ask for gifts or needs?" And he said, "I'm not the one that delays. The kingdom is partnership. And as you do for others, others will do for you. The delay is my son or daughter. When I ask them, they delay, wavering or wondering if they should do what I've asked them on your behalf. My children are quick to receive, but not always quick to give." How long will you delay the prompting of the Lord? How long will you delay being the answer to someone's prayer and God's instructions? So today, I want you to thank God that he provides for you daily and your needs, and thank him that you don't have to beg him to take care of you. But right now, I want you to picture what's in your heart. What are you dreaming? What are you asking? What is a gift that you would love to have from your Father? Dream with him. Is it a business? Is it a home? Is it your family coming to the Lord? What is it? Dream about it. Hold that in your head. I want you to thank God for those dreams and ask him to fulfill your dreams and desire. Thank him for being a father who gives good gifts. thank him that he never gets tired of hearing you ask him to fulfill your dreams. For he says, knock. Knock often. Ask often. Father, I thank you for your faithfulness. I thank you for the gift of wisdom that you have given to each and every one of us. We praise you for your faithfulness. We praise you for being such a good father. Father, your children have desires and dreams. Thank you for making their dreams come true. Father, I pray that you give them words of knowledge and wisdoms to run after their desires. Father, I impart to each one today a faithfulness to keep asking and to keep seeking you in prayer. Just as your goodness chases after us, we also chase after your goodness. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So I'd like you to come up and give to this house and have those dreams, have those desires in your heart as you come, because he's a good father. You can text to give to 888-546-7317 or go on Two Guys in the Bible and hit donate there. But please come forward. Thank you. Thank you.
on, let's stand. Let's get back into worship. Thank you, Jesus. Let my people go. Now we're not doing that song, but that just got stuck in my head. Swear, now every time I hear Uptown Funk somewhere, I'm going to let my people go. That's going to happen every time. Hallelujah. Yeah, right. I don't think so. Hallelujah. Come on, let's get back into worship. Thank you, Jesus. Let's stand. Lift your hands all over the room. I'm going to ask you to step out of your comfort zone this morning. We call this area down up front the river because His presence flows like a river. Amen. Hallelujah. So I'm going to ask if you would step out and just come down to the front and worship with us this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, everybody run up here all at once. Hallelujah. Don't be shy. I promise you, nobody's going to bite. There's
right.
Power in worshiping together.
That's
come
right.
on. Hallelujah. In Acts chapter 16, Paul and Silas are in prison, and the Bible says that when they began to worship together, the walls began to shake.
Yes.
Come on, the prison doors fell off. They fell right down, hallelujah, and they were able to be free. And what's great about it is they're not the only ones that were set free that day.
That's right.
Everyone in that prison who just happened to be there were set free also. Come on. Hallelujah, because they were in that presence. Hallelujah. Come on, do you believe that? Do you believe that your praise, you pressing in, can save somebody else? Come on, can get them on the path they need to be. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Say, it ain't me. That's right. It's God, but He works through you. Come on. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's praise. Come on, we'll praise Him anywhere. Amen?
That's right.
Come on, let's praise Him anywhere. Hallelujah. Come on, sing. Sometimes you gotta dance through the darkness, sing through the fire, praise when it don't make sense. Sometimes you gotta step down the giant, worship from the lion's den. Sometimes you gotta shout it from the mountain, louder in the valley, trusting that He's gonna get you there. Sometimes you gotta welcome the wonder, wait for the answer, worship with your hands in the air. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give Him praise, give Him praise in the highest. Praise, give Him praise, give Him praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, He is worthy of all of our praise. Sometimes you gotta praise in the prison, cry out to heaven, shout it till the doors swing wide. Sometimes you gotta stand in your shackles, brave in the battle, worship with your hands held high. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give Him praise, give Him praise in the highest. Praise, give Him praise, give Him praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, He is worthy of all of praise. Give Him praise, give Him praise in the highest. Praise, give Him praise, give Him praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, He is worthy of all of our praise. Come on, this is my favorite part of this song. Come on, faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why, I'll praise you anywhere. Come on, He's faithful all our life, amen? Come on, He's faithful even when we don't feel like He is. He's still faithful, come on. He's still there. You say, I don't feel him. Oh, he's still there. Trust me. Hallelujah. Come on, sing this. Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why I praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath, I praise you anywhere. Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why I praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath, I praise you anywhere. Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why I praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath. Come on, one more time, sing. Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why I praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath, I praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, he is worthy of all of our praise. Give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, he is worthy of all of our praise. I praise you anywhere. Oh, oh, mountain, oh, valley, I know that you're with me there. I praise you anywhere. Oh, come on, lift up a shout of praise this morning. Come on.
I praise you anywhere.
Oh, we'll praise you anywhere. We'll praise you anywhere. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, stay right where you are. Just lift your hands. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. How he loves us. Come on, do you know how much he loves you? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He loves you so deeply, you can never fathom it. Come on, our minds can't comprehend his love. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. As we move into resurrection season into Easter Sunday next week, thank you, Jesus, that you died for our sins. Thank you, Father, for sending your Son. You loved us enough to send your Son to sacrifice for us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Come on, let's worship. Jealous of me, love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me, and oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us, how he loves us so. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending the knee. The weight of his winning mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. Come on, sing. Yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. Yeah, he loves us. Redemption by the grace in his eyes. If his grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. So heaven meets earth like a sloppy wet kiss, and my heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. Yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Lift your hands all over the room. Just begin to sing your own song this morning. Just begin to enter into his presence this morning. Come on. Father, we're here. We're here right now. We want more of you, Father. We need you, God. We need you more than ever, Father. Come on, we need healing in the room this morning. Oh! See, no. Hearing this morning, somebody in this room or watching online, you had some type of head injury, and it's been giving you fits here lately. It's been causing migraines, it's been causing some pain. Now's the time to deal with it. God wants to meet you right where you are and deal with it right now. So if that's you, come on, there are people that will pray for you. If you're watching online, comment through. Right there on the Facebook page, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, just stretch your hands forth right now. Father, we thank you for your healing anointing. We thank you for your restoration power. Come on, and we believe and declare right now that every cell in our body be renewed and made whole in the name of Jesus. Come on, every single cell that makes yourself up is renewed and made whole in the name of Jesus. Come on, do you believe he can do it this morning? No matter what you're going through, no matter what the doctors say, come on. Every single cell in your body is made whole and renewed right now. Come on. See, no. Whoa. Thank you, Jesus. Just stretch your hands and pray in the Spirit right now. There's something stirring. There's something happening right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, I feel the healing anointing this morning. Is there anybody here this morning that needs healing right now? Anybody here? Come on, there's people that will pray. This altar is open. Come down and get prayed for. Hallelujah. Come on, the Spirit is here. God is here right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Every voice you sing.
Yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us.
Come on, just feel the Lord, the love of the Father envelop you right now. Come on, it doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter where you're from. Come on, the love of God encircle you right now. You say, I'm in a mess. That's okay. God will love you right in your mess. Come on. Come on, give the Lord praise one more time this morning. Come on, is he good? Is he good? Come on, lift up praise. Hallelujah. Come on. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise God. Is anybody thankful that you have a God that loves you? You know, one of my favorite scriptures in the Bible is when it says that he loved us even as sinners. Like before you ever made a decision to love him, he was already sold out in loving you. Isn't that amazing? Which then tells me if that decision was made then, there's no decision that you can make now that's going to make him stop loving you.
Yeah, right.
You can't do it. That's what Romans 8 is all about. You need to go check it out. There is nothing that is going to separate us from the love of Christ. Praise God. How's everybody doing? You all right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. They don't know. They don't know, Nathan. Well, I hope you still got a shout. You remember a couple weeks ago, we talked about a shout.
Yep.
There's a shout that causes God to take notice. Hope you still got that. Last week, we found out making quality decisions is the way to go, and you're here. You did it. You made a quality decision to be at church this morning. Hey, this is better. How many of you, well, don't raise your hands. This is better than any prison in the state. I'll just say that. I won't ask who's been there. This is better than any prison or hospital, I can tell you that. Praise God. Well, maybe you do know or don't know this is Palm Sunday. What does that mean, Palm Sunday? For you carnal devil worshipers who that love bunnies more than Jesus and pagan gods and goddesses, I mean, Easter Sunday is coming. I love how social media just freaks out about this stuff. I have my own opinions on that, and they go like this. I don't care what you want to call it. My Jesus came here, and he laid aside his mighty weight and glory to come down here and live and die and raise again, praise God. And I think it ought to be celebrated, and I don't care how you celebrate it. I don't really care. I'm happy he did it. Are you happy he did that? Yeah, well, you ought to be, or you wouldn't be sitting here, I can tell you that. How many of you know God's moved in your life to save your life? Come on, praise God. Well, I'm not going to take too long this morning. I just wanted to challenge you with something here this morning is, we want to take that quick journey into the Holy Week, right? This kind of kicks off the Holy Week, if you will. What we would call a Holy Week would mark the beginning of the end of Jesus' time here upon the earth in human flesh. And but there's something that I really want you to see this morning in the book here. Dr. Luke is where we're going to start in chapter 19. And sorry, Carlissa, I can't give you any more. I can't stall any more. She's getting there. She's got to do the scriptures and the words and the, you know, take care of Curtis and whatever else. That right there, Ray, is full time. Dr. Luke, chapter 19. After telling this story, Jesus went on to Jerusalem, walking ahead of the disciples. And just imagine, you know, you can see this play out in front of you. And as he came to the towns of Bethphage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives, he sent two disciples ahead. And he said, I want you to go into the village over there, he told them. And as you enter it, you're going to see a young donkey tied there that nobody has ever ridden. And I want you to untie it and bring it here. And if anybody asks, why are you untying that colt, just say, the Lord needs it. Remember that statement. The Lord needs it. The Lord needs it. So they went and they found the colt, just as Jesus had said. And sure enough, they were untying it. The owner asked, why are you untying that colt? I imagine that's a fair question. Why are you over here untying my colt? And the disciple simply replied, the Lord needs it. Again, the Lord needs it. This is so amazing as Jesus is fulfilling prophecy that is spoken over in Zechariah 9 and verse 9. And it says, rejoice, O people of Zion. Shout in triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, yet he is humble. Riding on a donkey's colt. The Lord needed that donkey, I want you to think about this, to begin the fulfillment of what would be the end of his life here on the earth. He had to have this donkey to begin this process, to fulfill what God had planned all along, spoken some hundreds of years earlier, prophesied, the Lord needs it. It was prophetic. Jesus had to have this donkey to be able to complete this task that he was going to do for us. And so it comes to pass, Jesus, as God has spoken in that prophecy, it was all set up and taken care of. Now imagine this. I mean, in our day and age, imagine this. Two men approach you and say, we're taking your brand new car that nobody's ever driven. Why? Well, the pastor needs it. I feel prophetic now, Nathan. No. Maybe that was pathetic. All right. But that's what happened here. These guys just walk up and said, hey, we're taking your brand new car. Why? Well, the Lord needs it. Well, okay. I mean, this guy's just like, well, then take it. What I'm saying is this. Look at how God had to work on all these people to get this to come to pass. This guy's just having a normal day, and these two guys walk up. Why are you untying that colt? The Lord needs it. Well, by all means, take it. That's amazing to me. We're going somewhere with this. Back to Luke 19, verse 35. So they brought the colt to Jesus. They threw their garments over it for him to ride on. As he rode along, the crowd spread out their garments on the road ahead of him. And when he reached the place where the road started down the Mount of Olives, all of his followers began to shout and sing as they walked along, praising God for the wonderful miracles that they had seen. Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven. But some of the Pharisees among the crowd said, teacher, rebuke your followers for saying things like that. And he replied, if I kept quiet, the stones along the road would burst into cheers. But as he came closer to Jerusalem and he saw the city ahead, he began to weep. Now we know, weep. As we know, now we're going to enter into the rest of the week as he's done this. We see Jesus going into the temple, what he finds those people selling those items. Remember, he wasn't happy about that. He comes in there and they're disrespecting the temple. And so he stands there and fastens a whip. I mean, this is on his last week of his life here. He fastens this whip while he's watching. I mean, that probably took a minute as he's sitting there watching. And he's fastening this whip. And we know he goes down into that temple and he flips the tables and he ran the people out that were selling things in the temple like a marketplace. And so he fashions that whip. He runs them out of there. And then I love what it says. Then the moment he got all that out, he brought everybody back into the temple that needed healed and he healed them all. Isn't that amazing? How you get some things out and we can get some other good things in. Praise God. And so he brought in all those that needed healing. And he healed every single one of them. Then he begins to speak of the future, kind of dropping hints to the guys. Guys, it's on us. My time is short. My time is up. Remember, they're getting nervous about it. He even got rebuked at one time. Far be it from you, Lord. I mean, just, you know, he's trying to give them, guys, it's on us. We're here. And so, but I love this, that he's still teaching daily in the temple on what would be the last week of his life upon this earth. I mean, I love that he pressed even harder and kept preaching and kept teaching all the way to the end. It's amazing, and I love that. He talked about the widow's mite as they witnessed that woman come and give all that she had. We know that now Judas has allowed the devil to get into his heart, it said, and to convince him, and he's agreed to betray Jesus. He's allowed the entrance of the devil into his heart. He had no restrictions there, nothing to put that up against. And so we know the Last Supper, the prediction of Peter's denial, and Peter's denying that he's going to deny him, you know, and he's like, no, you're going to deny me. All leading to one of the most amazing acts we know that any man could do, and that is to die for someone else. Amazing. But what I want to focus on, as amazingly powerful as all of that is and all this story that's leading up to his death on that day, how many things had to fall in place perfectly. Remember, I asked you to remember the statement, the Lord needs it. The Lord needs it. He was talking about that donkey for Jesus to be able to fulfill what God set out for. And you think about this, to set out to bring salvation to the entire world forever, he had to start with, I got to have that donkey. There's something there that I need in the natural. I've got to have that donkey to fulfill this. And so Jesus has needs outside of the supernatural. The Son of God was in need. He needed things here to line up in the natural to be able to accomplish the supernatural. And so I just want a few minutes to talk to you about how it is that Jesus needs you. And no, I'm not calling you a donkey. Or any other word that might be associated with that that Nathan likes to say all the time from the pulpit. Yes, there was a bus and I put you right there. I'm sorry. Jesus needs you. And I know we usually focus on all that Jesus did, right? This story is all about Jesus. I mean, when we see it leading up to him, and I mean, it's all about Jesus, and it leads to where he hung on that cross and he took our sins and he became sin who knew no sin so that we can become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. What a trade out. Amazing. Took all of our shortcomings and our sicknesses and our diseases and our pain and shame, and he became sin. But see, he could not do it alone. Jesus could not fulfill this greatest mission in what he was supposed to do in saving the world without help. He couldn't do it. For Jesus to start the process, he needed help. And I want you to know, for Jesus to complete the work of salvation for all of mankind, guess what? He needs you. He needs your help. He has to have you. He cannot do it alone because Jesus needs you. Let's look at it. In Luke 9, 23 through 27, then he said to the crowd, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way and take up your cross daily and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you're going to lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. What do you benefit if you gain the whole world, but you yourself are lost or destroyed? If anyone is ashamed of me and my message, the Son of Man will be ashamed of that person when he returns in his glory and in the glory of the Father and the holy angels. I tell you the truth, some standing here right now will not die before they see the kingdom of God. But I love this verse 23. He said to them, if anybody desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. What does that mean, take up your cross? What's he talking about here? Many, we know, view the cross as that worldwide symbol of Christianity. That's how a lot of people see it. But I want to start by saying how important this is, because I don't know if we realize that Jesus could not and can not walk out the plan of salvation without you. He can't do it. The cross represents, how many of you got born again from somebody? Somebody led you to the Lord. Somebody with a body led you to the Lord. I mean, I don't know, there might be a handful of you that had the divine intervention. Jesus came into your bedroom type of thing, maybe. I mean, Matt Davis had that experience. But others have certainly fed into him, talked to him, so he would know who it was. But the cross represents so much more. Dying to self and living for him. Taking up a cross is even more than wearing a cross around our neck. I want to show you something here because I need you to see some things about your cross today. How important your cross is. I understand our importance, of course, lies in the importance of his cross, absolutely. But I want you to see that when you're standing out here, possibly this summer, if you're going to be joining us down there on that stage this summer. It could just be, of course, in your everyday life. You could be at school. You could be at work, the grocery store, gas station, whatever. You go out to eat. I want you to be sure that you understand the importance of what it is that you are doing. Because for some, and we understand that eternity is all around us, isn't it? When we see these people out here, they're one breath away from an eternal decision. That if something happens, they will go to heaven or hell. Heaven or hell. You all did make a quality decision. They may not know that yet. How important is it going to be
for them to be able to see what your role is. Because as these people walk through our lives every day, and even this summer, and you think about this now, this is an amazing statistic to think about because it is true. When we go down to that strip, do you understand that there will be at least 1 million people that will pass by that stage on weekends this summer? We have the opportunity to be standing there preaching Jesus to at least 1 million people that are going to be passing by that stage this summer. Millions of people will come to that stage. It's predicted this summer that starting now through September, about 5 million people are going to be here at the lake. That's what they're predicting. It's kind of going up and up. We keep breaking records every year. I think you can see that when you try to pull out. It's different now, isn't it? 5 million people. But will they experience an unexpected cross? This is what I'm talking about this morning. Unexpected crosses. Will they find salvation? I want to talk to you about the unexpected cross, because we understand when those Roman soldiers, they were swinging that whip, and those Roman soldiers were driving those nails, it wasn't just them alone. This was all of mankind that Jesus was carrying this. We did that to him. We did it to him. They took Jesus. We know, as it mentioned, he rode that donkey into town. And, of course, eventually we get to the Last Supper, where Jesus, you know, said one of them is going to betray him. We later see him in the garden, where he could find no natural help from his disciples. You know, I mean, here he's struggling. He's having a hard time here. And I love this, because we get to see his humanity in that moment. And I love that part, that he was really having a hard time physically with this task that was coming up. And he caught them sleeping instead of praying. And Jesus asked, could you not tarry just 1 hour? Which is why we ask you to come on Friday nights for 1 hour. Could you not tarry 1 hour? 1 hour. 1 hour. Do you think prayer changes things? 1 hour. That's all we're asking. We know that Jesus is struggling so much that he asked his Father if there could even be another way. I mean, this is the first time we see Jesus questioning his Father on the plan. Everything else has been, I do his will. I do his will. This time he's like, this is a rough one. I'm not liking this one. All of a sudden, this one, I can't get any help from my boys. This is rough, man. I'm having a hard time. But nonetheless, not my will, but yours be done. Anybody thankful that he said that? And how he's so under duress that he's suffering from a medical condition caused by extreme life-threatening stress that causes your blood pressure to raise so dangerously high that the small vessels in your forehead will burst, causing drops of blood. That is life-threatening. Your blood pressure can't get much higher than that right there without dying. And Jesus was right there, but it wasn't time yet. He's sweating drops of blood. He's exhausted already when the soldiers find him. Right, he's got a friend that kisses him on the cheek. I mean, this is a guy that he loved, and he betrays him. He even calls him friend. He even calls him friend at that moment, and he betrays him. We know that feeling. And now they take him, they begin to beat him, and we know before they took that cross, he'd gone way too long without any sleep, and he's already suffering a terrible beating, and they've already ripped the flesh from his body. Why? So that he could fulfill that prophecy that's in Isaiah, that by his stripes we are healed. He did that for you and I. He did that for those that we're going to see. He did that for those that we're going to encounter at the strip, those that we see, every single person. And so maybe for some, they're going to see the backside of an unexpected cross. And what do I mean by that? Were those stripes that bled for their healing. The backside of Calvary, where that blood flowed that would purchase freedom from all sickness and disease. Will they see that when you carry your cross? Would you be one that could tell somebody, he's a healer? As you're carrying that cross, as you're carrying Jesus' burden, as you're carrying this message, will they see that unexpected cross when you come across their path and you hear that C word, or you find out that somebody's got a condition or something's happening? Will they see that cross? Are you carrying that cross? We now know he's suffering total opposite end of the physical spectrum, where his blood pressure is so low at this point, he's bleeding all the wounds that have taken place. They've put a spear in his side. This man's bleeding out. They bring him back. We see they place this cross upon his back before this, predicted to be about 80 pounds, 40 pounds per beam. And here he is. The Bible says that they forced him to carry that cross. They're going to parade him through here, and he's struggling under the weight of that cross that he was carrying for you and I and for every one of these people. And he struggled with this. The Bible says that he was carrying that cross because of the loss of blood and the exhaustion and the weight of that cross, and really the weight of the world that was upon him, I'm sure, at that moment. And he fell under the weight of the cross. He reached that place. Couldn't do it. Imagine this. I mean, this is amazing to me. The man that said, I only do what my Father says to do. I only say what the Father would say. Imagine for the first time in his life, and I'm talking his eternal life before he ever came to earth, here's Jesus for the very first time, this one task that God needs him to do, this one, to complete this one assignment. And imagine it, Jesus, the very Son of God, the Son of Almighty God, born of a virgin, walked on water, healed the sick, raised the dead, cast out demons, fed 5,000, stood before a legion of demons, walked through a crowd of people that were going to throw him off of a cliff and try to kill him, escaped death at every turn, and now, at the most important assignment of all humanity, is hanging upon this one thing right here, and Jesus falls under the weight of that cross. He can't do it. He can't do it. Take up your cross, he said. What was he showing us? I need you to help me carry the cross. I need you to help me complete the task of bringing salvation to the world. So maybe for some that are going to be walking by this summer, as we see these people, maybe as they see you, will they see that you picked up a cross? How many of you ran into people and you're like, what is that about you? You know what I'm talking about? People that do that, you know, they're like, what is that about you? I mean, when they're talking about your Christianity, not when you were a weirdo. I mean, you're weirdos, but different now. You're like our kind of weirdo. I mean, we're aliens. We don't belong here, but this is what I'm talking about. They recognize something. This is what I'm talking about. As you pick up that cross and follow him, maybe they're going to see an unexpected cross that shows them that Jesus understands when you've gone as far as you can go and you got nothing left. You got nothing left. He understands that. He gets that. Maybe that's your cross. When they just can't take it anymore, when there's no more strength, maybe that's what the unexpected cross holds for them. Will they see that when they see you? Will they see somebody who made it, who picked up the cross and can lead them in the strength and the peace of the Lord? Will they see that you made it, that you carried that cross and you made it? Jesus understands when we've gone as far as we can go in our own strength. I mean, this is the man that walked on water, raised the dead, cast out devils, calmed winds and seas, and healed bodies, and he couldn't complete the greatest mission that he had ever. He couldn't complete it. One thing he was born for, and he fell underneath the weight of that cross. See, we forget that this cross is more than it appears, because on that day you understand every devil in hell, every sin of the world, every imp, every sickness, every disease, every poverty, every accusation, every lie, every bondage, every infirmity, every failure, every malfunction, abuse, and pain, all of that hastened in hordes to do battle with Jesus on that cross that day. All of hell cleared out to be there that day. And I'm sure Satan just thought, finally, we did it. The Bible says, boy, what a mistake he made. Says if he had known, he would have never had done it. If he had known what was going to happen, he never would have done it. The cross was no ending, my friends. It was the beginning. It's not a subtraction. It's a plus sign. It's an addition. In that cross, it was Jesus against the world and all the world had to offer, and everything came to fight that day. All the same things that would ever fight you and I, that we could ever run into. Your Bible says that Jesus triumphed over them on that cross. So you have to understand that Jesus, what he fell under that day, it's not just a cross made of wood. That's not what happened that day. I need you to see why it is or how it is that Jesus needs you. I need you to see what else died on that day. Not just a man named Jesus, that he took himself in his body, took all of that upon himself, all my sins and your sins and their sins and any sins that were going to be committed after that. And the cross is a revelation of grace that the world doesn't even know. He didn't take away part of the sins, but the whole had been nailed to the cross, and that's good news. What will they see in your cross? How can the world see what it means without you carrying your cross? Colossians 2, 13 and 14, when you were dead in your transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he made you alive together with him, having forgiven us of all of our transgressions, all of them, every single one of them, having canceled out the certificate of debt consisting of the decrees against us, which was hostile to us. And he's taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. Little children, I write these things unto you that you not sin. But if you do sin, even if you sin tomorrow, you have an advocate with the Father, and he's never lost a case. Never lost a case. He took all that list that the devil had against you, everything that you've ever done, all the accusations, all the garbage. This is why when the devil tries to bring up your past, it doesn't matter, because this right here says it was all written down there for everybody to see. Jesus saw it, and he nailed it to the cross, and he bled all over it, so you can't see it anymore. It's gone. Forever canceling them out, it said. Forever canceling anything that was against you, it's out. So when we stand to take up our cross, yes, it's about the man that died in Calvary. Yes, it's about the Son of God. But as you stand there with your cross, the Bible says that Jesus, the very Son of God, could not carry out the plan of salvation for mankind. And he fell. He knows what it is to go just as far as you can go. That cross represents the one that knows what it feels like when you can't take it anymore. And Jesus couldn't do it alone. The Bible says in Matthew 28, one Simon, the Bible says he had a special purpose, one Simon in the crowd. And so maybe we have a Simon in here today. Maybe there's somebody over here, back here. One Simon, it said. One Simon, one man, one woman, one of these children in here, one Simon of Cyrene. He didn't go to be singled out that day. It was a normal day for him. He was going to go watch the show. What's this big deal about this Jesus? And what's going on? What's everybody gathered over here for? He's just living life. And then all of a sudden, what happened? In a moment of time, his life would forever change. A divine moment when all of a sudden, Jesus falls with that cross right in front of this man. Right in front of this one man. An unexpected cross appeared in his life. It was at this point his life was never going to be the same. As he was instructed, you better pick up that cross and carry it for Jesus. Now, I want you to answer this question today, because Jesus could not do it without this one man. He said, I need you. I'm asking you today, would you carry his cross? Would you carry it? Would you let this world know that you have an opportunity to have an unexpected cross in their life, where you could go and put that right in front of them and have them make a decision? Would somebody come alongside the lost and dying world that are headed towards their death, and it's looking like they're going to be crucified, and would you come alongside and carry a cross, help somebody that's in need? Would you let this world see a cross that represents their sins are taken away? Those people that, like I mentioned, they just can't take it anymore. A cross, an unexpected cross. Some of you are going to carry a cross of forgiveness to know what it's like to be hated by others, and yet I forgave them. And you can do it too, because how many of you know unforgiveness will eat you alive? Boy, there's a hateful world out here that needs to see that cross. They need to see that cross. We let that sinner see a cross of salvation, that drug addict find freedom with an unexpected cross. Those of you saved from addictions, take up that cross. It wasn't easy. You have to do it every day. Take up that cross every day. Take it up every day. People that we're going to encounter this summer all running from something, right? We chose the Strip because of the amount of bars and secular entertainment that's down there, you know, and of course we know it kind of seems to be the hub and activity for some other very questionable things that take place. We wanted to go there on purpose, high traffic area. And so we have all these people coming to get away from all their world's problems, so they say. The beautiful Lake of the Ozarks, right? If you've ever seen the commercials, it's gorgeous, right? I love this place. I've lived here my entire life. What they don't show you on the commercial is the girl that just had an abortion, that didn't just kill that child that she was carrying, but it's killing her inside. We'll see her this summer. We'll see her. She'll be there somewhere. We'll see that girl. You won't see that commercial with somebody in that boat suffering from addiction, puking out the side of the boat. You don't see that commercial. Come to the beautiful Lake of the Ozarks. The ones that are going to overdose and end up in our hospital this summer. The ones that won't make it. The ones that are going to be drunk driving. That maybe, just maybe, maybe, before they get in that car, they have a cross. Maybe. That young man, woman who just graduated, they don't even know what they're doing yet with their lives. Maybe they can find a cross of hope. Somebody who God reached down, saved you from death. I shared this before. It's worth repeating. Some summers ago, a friend of mine was working here at a lakefront bar. one of the first ones that were lakefront back then. Of course, the place is packed out, and she calls me, and I mean, it's late, and she's in a panic. Donnie, a man just fell over dead. He just fell over dead at the bar. He's been here drinking all day. She's a waitress there. He's been here drinking all day, and this man has died and fallen off of this onto the floor right now. And she's yelling over the speakerphone, and she's like, "What do I do? What do I do?" And I said, "Speak life." And I hear her on this phone running and just yelling, "You will live and not die. You will live and not die." And all of a sudden, I hear all the people go, "Oh, whoa," as the guy sits up. They get the ambulance. She rides in the ambulance, goes to the hospital with him, and gets him born again. Unexpected cross. Unexpected cross. Understood what it was to carry a cross, because she used to be addicted. She got it. She knew. She was able to relate to that. And Jesus came into her life. She carried her cross. She gave up her life to follow Jesus and carry that cross, that burden. But we don't know the people that we're going to run across. No commercials of the lake with somebody that's going to jump off that bridge if something doesn't change, and I mean change now. We're not going to see that commercial this summer. But will they see your cross? Will they see your cross? Jesus said, "My yoke is easy, my burden is light." Will you take up that cross? Will you become Jesus for somebody? Jesus needs you. He needs you. Jesus needs you. This man that says that Jesus could not, for the very first time, he could not do the Father's will alone. The mission of salvation said, "I have to have mankind help me." Isn't that something? To complete what it was that Jesus was going to do, a man had to step in. To finish what Jesus is going to do, men and women have to step in. It was needed to be the fulfillment, like that donkey was, that fulfillment of that prophecy. As he rode in triumph, that donkey carried salvation, the beginning of the salvation plan. That donkey was carrying the person of salvation. And now here we are. We are carriers. Isn't that right? Christ in us, the hope of glory. That's their only hope of glory, is the Christ that is in you. Will you carry your cross? You will be used for victory. Can the call of God ride upon you to be delivered to the people where you carry that cross? Because if you can, you're carrying that message to the world. And all that the cross represented on that day and every day, will you let them see that it's not the end of life, it's the beginning of their life, that they can die and yet be born again? What an amazing message. The Apostle Paul nailed it. He understood this, Galatians 2:20. "I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. But the life that I live now, I live in the flesh. I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." Isn't that amazing? The cross isn't the don'ts and don't get to's. It's the you get to. We've made our religion, we made it religion and not relationship. We made it religion, and people are so worried about the don'ts. We're not telling them what they get to do when they do this. You get to be free. You get to have joy and peace. You get to miss hell. You get to spend an eternity with your Lord and Savior. You get to be healed. You get to be a more than a conqueror. I mean, come on. When you dare to take up a cross and see somebody delivered, deliverance, forgiveness, freedom, and hope again, will you let them see maybe that unexpected way out of hell that they didn't even know there was a way? All the guilt and shame and condemnation, would you pick up your cross, help Jesus fulfill the mission of the Great Commission in telling the world there's a God in heaven that is so madly in love with you that he sent his Son to die for you? Will you carry an unexpected cross? Jesus left us instructions knowing that he needed you. It's called the Great Commission. Did you know it's not called the Great Suggestion? I mean, if you want to. That's not what he said. He said, "Go into all the world." This sounds like taking up a cross. "Preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. He who does not will be condemned. And these signs will follow those who believe." Do you believe? Lift up your hand if you believe. Then I'm telling you something. Guess what's going to happen this summer? There will be signs. There will be signs. This says there will be signs. Follow those that believe. This is not an empty message when you carry a cross. There are signs. What will happen in my name? They're going to cast out demons. Are there some demons that need casting out on the strip? Yeah. They'll speak in new tongues. They'll take up serpents if they drink anything deadly. It'll by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. So then after that, the Lord had spoken to them. He was received up into heaven, meaning what? It is finished. But you ain't finished. And he sat down at the right hand of God, and what did they do? They went out and they preached everywhere. They picked up that cross and they went out there, and what happened? The Lord worked with them, and he confirmed the word through accompanying signs. Guys, he won't leave you hanging on the cross. He won't leave you hanging. When you pick up that cross, he's going to back you up. They picked up their cross. Will you pick up the cross and fulfill the mission of the Great Commission? Will you be that unexpected cross for somebody that never knew? I believe all these lost and dying hordes of humanity walk by, they're going to see their unexpected cross drop before them. A cross that had all those handwritten ordinances on it. A cross that holds all the accusations and the deeds against them, and a cross that held all the certificate of debts that they could never pay. They feel that guilt and shame arise when we approach them about Jesus. You can see it, right? That wall that goes up sometimes when you approach somebody and you begin to tell them, and they kind of get that weird thing going there. But what they need to see on your cross is all that was nailed to the cross. And again, that he bled over all of that. That God's not holding any of that against them, because he held it against his son. Every bit of it. And it's null and void. But you have to carry the cross for somebody. Let them see that cross that's a bridge out of hell, a plus sign in a minus world. Not a negative thing, but a positive thing. It's an addition to their life. Would you commit to helping Jesus today and bringing that salvation to the world? He needs you. He needs you. He's untied you and loosed you. Just for this purpose, because he needs you. He needs you. Praise, I know you can carry a tune, but can you carry a cross? Gary can carry a beat. You carry a cross? Curtis just carries on, but can you carry a cross? Glory to God. That is Curtis's cross. People talk to that guy. What will they see as they see you? Will you pick up that cross and follow me? Jesus needs you to finish this thing. He needs you to finish it. If you would commit today, I'd ask you to stand to your feet right now, if you would, please. And I just want you to take a moment here. I want you to lift your hands to heaven. And if you really will commit to do it, I want you to say, Lord, I commit myself to you. Just talk to him about it. Let me read this to you while you're standing there in Isaiah 6. So I said, woe is me, for I am undone, because I'm a man of unclean lips. He did not feel worthy to do this. And you don't either. I know you don't. And I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. And one of the seraphim flew by me, having in his hand a live coal that he had taken from the tongs at the altar. And he touched my mouth with it, and he said, behold, this has touched your lips. Your iniquity is taken away, and your sin purged. Also, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? Who will go for us? And I said, here I am. Send me. Do you see this? Anything that's going on in your life today that's been working against you, God will cleanse that. And then he's going to restore it all. You are worthy to carry that cross for him. You're worthy to do it. God's already committed himself to you irrevocably, but will you do the same? Because the power is in the choice. The power is in the choice. Will you choose? He won't make you. Will you choose today? The power is in the choice. God's already committed himself, but will you pick up that cross? Because if you will, the power of that choice will unleash that anointing that destroys yokes and removes burdens. That's about 99% of the people right there, yokes and burdens. Will you pick up that cross? And when you do, everything else is going to die, but you're going to live. And you're going to live like you never have before. But would you allow him to cleanse you again? And will you answer that call today? Who will I send? Will it be you? Will you pick up that cross? That's between you and him. I can't make you do it. Pick up that cross today. But if you will, say, here I am. Send me. Do you mean that today? Quickly, I felt led to ask this today. If there's someone or someones in here that feel like, you know, I need to rededicate my life to him. I've just not been doing it. I've not been walking the walk, not even talking the talk. If that's you, I want your hand in the air. See, here we don't say every head bowed and every eye closed. You know it? Because we're not ashamed of the gospel. One of the greatest things you can do is give your life to the Lord, and we act like it's the most secretive thing, scary thing ever. Get your head down, nobody looking around. We don't want nobody to see you getting born again. If you want to, if you would rededicate your life, I want you to lift your hands. If you feel like I need that in my life this morning, raise your hand. Get your hands up. I'm going to ask you to do something else. I want you to come down here. I want you to do it. Because listen, you're not ashamed of him, are you? He's not ashamed of you. If you're going to do that, I want you to come down here. If you're going to rededicate your life to the Lord this morning, if you've never been born again to begin with, then I want you down here. Today's your day. Today's your day to make that quality decision that'll determine the rest of your life. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Anybody else? I'm not going to get in a hurry. If you feel like, hey, I need that touch again, you know. If you do, come down. It's all right. He's a good God, you know. Praise God. Thank you, brother. All right, give me some ladies over here. Give me some brothers over here. Let's minister to these people, yeah? It's what we do, right? It's the church. The rest of you, just stick with us for just a moment. Thank you, Lord. So they're going to pick up their cross and follow him today. They're going to lay everything aside. Thank you, Lord. God needs you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So greatest decision you can ever make. Thank you.
Praise God. All right, lift your hands back up if you would, please. Father, we love you, Lord. We thank you for your word. Father God, we thank you for Holy Spirit. And we thank you for sending your son. And Father, we do commit ourselves today to pick up that cross and to follow you. And we thank you, Father God, that you are backing us 100%. Lord, that as we go out there, we're never alone. Father, that you said that you would be right there with us. So, Lord, we thank you for the power of the cross, the power of the man that hung on that cross, but the man that didn't stay on that cross. Father, we thank you for that resurrection power. As we're leading into this week right here, we thank you for that power. Lord, as we truly commit ourselves to you again today, to take up our cross and follow you in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Praise God. Love you guys. Bless you. Do it daily. You won't regret it. Amen. 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 Bless you all. Have a wonderful, wonderful week.
Well, thanks again so much, you guys, for tuning in to Church at the MHC. I am thankful that you guys chose us to be your church today. Hey, if, like Pastor said, Pastor Don said, if you want to rededicate your life today to the Lord, it's simple as saying, Father God, I know I've turned away. But Father God, I just thank you that right now I turn my heart towards you. I turn my life towards you. I might have strayed. I might have gone astray. But I thank you that you are making the crooked way straight in Jesus' name. And that's all. That's all you have to pray. And you can do it right now in your home. And you can rededicate. You can turn your heart back to the Father. Because our gifts and our callings are without repentance. And so we can, it's nothing but a heart change. And it's nothing but just turning our hearts back to the Father, trusting in him again, allowing him to make that crooked path straight. And you can do that right now, right here in your home, wherever you're at. You can do that, and you can rededicate your life to the Lord. The Lord says that the gifts and callings are without repentance, and whatever he was speaking to you all those years ago, he didn't take them from you. He still wants you to fulfill that call of God that's on your life, that purpose that is on your life. And so I want you to realize that today, that when we turn our hearts back to God, then he immediately meets us where we're at, and he immediately says, okay, let's go do this, let's go do that thing I called you to do. And we all know what those are, but I encourage you, if you can do that right now, right here in your own home. You don't have to have a pastor lay hands on you. You don't have to have a evangelist or a teacher or a prophet lay hands on you. You can just change your heart. You can just internally say, okay, Lord, I might have been going this way, but I'm going to go this way. I'm going to go follow your path for my life. And if you have gone astray, I just want you to know you can do that right now in your own home. But I don't see any current prayer requests. So, Father God, I just lift up everyone watching today, Father. Father, I thank you that you are making their crooked path straight, that you are ordering their footsteps, Father, that you are, that their footsteps are ordered of you. Father God, I thank you that those gifts and those callings are without repentance. And so I thank you that in Jesus' name, that whatever you were speaking to their hearts before they turned away, before they allowed the world system to grab a hold of them, I thank you that's still there, that is still something that you're calling them to do, that you have purposed them to do. Father God, I just thank you that for their lives. I thank you that they are marked for you, Father. Father God, I thank you that you left the 99 for the one, and that you won't allow any of your sheep to be led astray. And I just thank you for what you're doing right now, that you are bringing back that one into the sheepfold, that you're bringing back that one into the flock. And I just thank you for it. I thank you that You are bringing back those kids, those children that have turned away from you, Father, and you are bringing them back unto you, Father. And Father, I think that's where revival starts. The revival starts in people's hearts turning towards you, Father. That you are lighting a fire in their spirit again for you, Father. That first love that they once knew, which is you, Father, I thank you that you are rekindling that love in their spirit for you, Father. And I just thank you that you are doing it right now in the name of Jesus. Well, we love you guys. Hey, tune in Tuesday night for Tuesday Night Healing School, as well as Wednesday night church at 7 p.m. If you need prayer, you know, reach out to Pastor Nathan or myself, or Pastor Don and Michelle. We would love to pray for you, stand with you, as well as you can call our prayer lines, 573-216-1871, and one of our prayer team members would love to pray with you that way as well. But we love you guys, and thank you so much again for making Church at the MHC your church today. We'll see ya.